and he's going to give us a talk about his DBMS. So please put our hands together and welcome Mr. Luca.
Hi guys, can you hear me? Maybe with the microphone.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Cool. So, welcome. It's my first time in Singapore. I love this city. And I'd like to present today the multi-model concept. So graph databases, we're talking about graph databases and multi-model. How many of you are really familiar with graph databases? Okay. How many of you are already using NoSQL database? MongoDB. Okay, cool. Okay, so we can start. I'm sorry to start with the very bad news. So, following Gartner, most of the projects about big data will fail this year. More than half of the projects. Why? Because of this. Today, if you want to create like a super scalable, fast application, you need multiple databases, right? So this is the Polyglot Persistence. This is an example of like a booking.com-like application. So if you need to store like the product, maybe a document database is a good solution because with just one call, you get all the data all together, right? So maybe MongoDB could be a good solution, right? Then maybe you want to do a recommendation. So if you like this hotel, maybe you could like also these other hotels, right? This is the classic recommendation system. And the graph databases are usually used to do recommendations. So I just making it for J because it's the most popular database, graph database. Then you want to store like, you know, transaction when people pay. And you don't trust about transaction, about the base consistency. So you want like a relational database because, you know, they are transaction. So I just picked my SQL, I could be Oracle. So any relational base that manage transactions. Then you want to also a search engine, right? So I want to look for all the hotels in Singapore. So you need something like Elasticsearch or Solr. So like a search engine across your database. And then if you want to scale up, you could use something like Redis, like a cache, or just a store session, right? So you end up having a lot of databases in your application. And the bad news is that there are no standards, even the same category, even, for example, between document databases, MongoDB and CacheDB, there are no standards. So it's up to you to move data across all the databases. So by writing ETL, Or maybe better, the same application is writing data across all the databases, right? So anything is up to you. And this could be really expensive, because maybe you guys are an expert on MongoDB, but you don't know anything about Neo4j, right? So you need maybe more people with different skills, right? And this is super expensive, even for some, it could be too expensive. So the main reason is that integrating a lot of databases all together could be really, really expensive. So go back to the big data. So big data is a lot of data, right? That's fine. I can have a lot of data. But data without the relationships, they lose a lot of value. So it's the relationship actually that adds incredible value to the data, right? But if you look to the NoSQL databases, we have about like 300 NoSQL databases, but we can say that the main four categories of NoSQL: key value, document, and column, and graph database. Graph databases are different than the other categories. Why? Who knows why? Why graph databases are different than key value, document, and column database? Any guess? No guess? Okay. Because they take care about relationships. Instead of the other databases, there is no trace of relationship at all. If you want to do a relationship with the MongoDB, for example, you have to store the ID and you have to do like the join in your application. So what the relational database actually is offering, you are doing in the application. Of course, it's not really fast. And if you look to the history, we have like data warehouse, right? Why data warehouse? Is a word over. Because the join cost was so expensive, and for this reason, we flat entire tables, like hundreds of columns, in just one table. So your analytics, your report will be super fast, because you don't do the joins, right, with this data warehouse. So why all the NoSQL categories about the data databases, they try to avoid relationships. Because the join. The join is evil. So the join is the problem. The join is what slows down any relational base. Why? How many of you are familiar with relational bases? Okay, all of you. Okay. So the join works in this way. Of course, you create an index, right? So anytime you cross two kinds of information, you cross the information by using the ID, right? So the ID usually is a foreign key and a primary key. So, okay, but with an index it should be fast, right? Not really. Why joins are so slow, when you have, especially when you have a lot of records? This is how it works if you look up in the index. Most of the indexes are based on a balanced tree algorithm. So if I want to look into my name, and there is the classic address book, right? So I start from the root node of the tree, of the index. I'm looking for L, so L is on the left. On the other level is on the right. Right again. Follow my name. So every time you look for a key or a name in an index, you're doing this job. This is easy because it was just 5 level of that. But can you imagine if you had million or billion of records? This tree could be very, very deep, right? And if you cross like 3-4 tables with all the joins, you can end up having like billions of join operation. And that's why the join is low. Because the join is a log n operation. And this is why, with rational bases, I'm sure that everybody can say that this is true. But the bigger is the database, the lower are the performance. Because this is the reason, because the index is growing and you have a much deeper index. So this is the main reason why you cannot scale the rational base, and any database is based on index when you want to resolve relationships. Cool, but graph databases in the NoSQL world, they keep relationships. So how can they do a relationship without having all this problem, all the problem of relational bases? Before looking how graph databases manage relationships, let's take a crash course about graph databases. So a graph database is just a set of vertices or nodes in the same where you store the data, this one, and edges or arcs is the same where you connect data, right? So this is the similar graph ever. Luca and Singapore. So we have two vertices, two nodes, and one relationship. You can see that there are a lot of graph types. We have a lot of graph types, but I'm just looking on property graph. Most of the graph databases, they implement the property graph model. So with this model, an edge has a direction, right? So Luca visited Singapore. Makes no sense, the opposite, right? But the cool thing about the edges is that I can cross in any direction. So I can start from, if I want to see all the places where Luca was, like 2017, I can start from Luca and get all the outgoing connection, right? If I want to know all the people that visited Singapore this year, I can start from Singapore and get all the incoming connection, right? So the edges can be crossed in both directions. But when you create the edge, you provide the direction that, you know, give the meaning of the edge. Of course, you can store properties. So any vertex can have properties. Usually, in graph databases, they work in schemaless mode. So you just put properties, like a document. But you can also store properties on the edge. You can say, Luca visited Singapore in 2016, for example. Okay. So you can have properties on vertices and edges. An edge can connect only two vertices. So how can you do one-to-end relationship? I can just use multiple edges. And every single edge can have different properties, right? Okay, so with graph databases, you can use a graph database like a relational database. So for example, with OrientDB, you can do select stuff from customer, you get all the results, and just works. But with graph databases, you can use a different path. You can use the traversal instead of query. How does it work? I can have all my clients connected to a root vertex called customer. So I can create like, so the blue vertex are the meta graph. So the additional information that I'm storing in the database for just retrieving my information quickly. Right? So the green one is actually my database. So I can create a vertex, a root vertex customers, where I connect all the customers. So if I want to know all my customers, I can start from customers as a root node and cross all the outgoing connection. Right? I can create like special customer root vertex where I connect only the special customer. So if I want to know, hey, give me all the special customer, I can do like select start from customer where blah blah blah. But I can just traverse the relationship between special customer and all the customer connected, right? And the same for stocks. Since everything is connected with the graph, I can move everywhere in any direction. If I want to know, hey, give me who bought the white soap, I can start from the stock, get the white soap, get the incoming connection to get the order, and incoming again. So incoming, incoming. And I will get Jim. So Jim purchased the white soap, right? So I can move outgoing, incoming, I can move in any direction in the graph database. Cool. But again, how can they manage a relationship without using the join? So what is the trick? Is the index field adjacency. So with the graph database, to cross the relationship, you don't use an index at all. How does it work? It's very easy. We have pointers, persistent pointers. It's like memory pointers, but they are persistent. So every time you create a vertex or an edge, OrientDB and any graph database assign an immutable ID. These numbers. So the first one is the south table where we store, and this is the position in the table. So it's an absolute position of that information in the database. So when orders has connection to different orders, actually it contains a list of pointers. So it contains a couple of pointers, right? So when I cross the relationship with the graph database, actually it's always a constant operation because I'm not to look into an index table to look for my actual position in the record. I already know the position of the record because it's stored as a pointer in the vertices, right? So this means that we jump from a log n algorithm to a constant one, or one. And this means that no matter if you're one or 100 billion of the vertices, the performance of traversing the relationship remains constant. It's always the same. And this is possible for the big data. That's it. There's no more for the graph. So perhaps it looks like, I have to do my homework. I don't remember to screw the graphs. But that's it. Vertices, edges, there is no more, right? Okay, so graphs are so simple to be so powerful. Let's go back to the Polyglot Persistence. So the Polyglot Persistence is just a word to say, two words actually, to say that you are using multiple databases in the same application. And if we look at the history, we can say that relational databases started in 1970, and for a lot of time, till 2009, when the NoSQL databases became popular. Actually, in the middle, there were like object databases, XML databases, but now they are used just for niche markets. But anyway, starting from 2009, it was not for granted that the database has to be relational, right? So I can use a document database, a column database. And in 2015, we started to see the word multi-model database. Somebody called like NoSQL 2.0. So what about multi-model? So which is this kind of evolution of the NoSQL databases? So multi-model is a one database able to handle different models at the same time. So I can have graphs, documents, key value, spatial, full text, object-oriented, and reactive. This is just an example, but I can have additional models. So with the multi-model database, the same engine is capable to manage all these models at the same time. So when I work with, so maybe I can have like documents like MongoDB, but I can connect documents like in a graph database. When we started with the multi-model, proposing a multi-model, nobody was listening, so we were pretty much alone. And actually, at the beginning was very hard because nobody knew that they need a multi-model database, right? So we started contrast ODB is a graph document database for a long time. Today, multi-model is very popular. But before today, I can say the milestone when multi-model became not popular, but at least considered as a category, was in 2012 during the keynote in NoSQL Matters conference, when for the first time the multi-model world has been introduced in the database world. And today we can say that it's very popular, and DataStax, so Cassandra and NoDB, they are multi-model today. So multi-model now is popular. So the leading NoSQL databases, they are NoSQL B or they are already multi-model, right? So there are two kinds of multi-model databases. We have a multi-model database where all the model live in the engine, so the engine actually is able to understand all different models at the same time. And you can build different layers on top of an existing engine. Like maybe you have a key value, or you have like a rational base, maybe you're just creating like a graph database layer. The problem with the layers is that you think having like a multi-model database, but you have a lot of transformation. Because every time you have a layer, you transform the graph to tables, for example, and vice versa. So layers are very expensive. But today, you can find multi-model databases that they claim to be multi-model, and this is true, but they are just layers on top of an existing engine. Cool. So I'd like to present ODB. It was the first multi-model database, and it is a native multi-model database. And it's open source, Apache license, so you can use for any purpose for free. There is also the enterprise edition, it's commercial, but we are looking to the community edition. So a multi-model database, of course, has a lot of features to other databases at the same time, right? So some of the features that are not present in any database, for example, the reactive model, and I'll try to explain later. But anyway, with just one database, you can have different features without using a lot of databases in your application. Okay, so what about the design of the database? So with like a cookie like application like before, this is super simple, of course, it's more complex. But at least I have a user and a product, right? So a product at my hotel. So user create an order. I want to book this hotel, right? And maybe after I book the hotel and the hotel was great, I want to write a review, right, about the product. And of course, there's a session. So while I'm booking the hotel, and you see in booking.com, like other 20 people are booking the same hotel at the same time, right? So we want to monitor all the session in real time. So if you want to use Polyglot Persistence, like in the second slide of this talk, maybe you have to use a different databases, like the user, for example, has to reside on the cache on the recommendation system because the user there is writing the reviews, and also in the order, right? So you have a lot of duplication data, and it is up to you to keep all this data synchronized, because there is no tool, there is no standard that keep this data synchronized for you. So it's up to you. And every time you change the data, you have to change maybe the ETL or this information in all the databases. So it's very, very complex. In the multi-model database, of course, your model is pure, it's plain. Just the multi-model database is able to handle any kind of complex domain with just one product. So there are a lot of models in the multi-model, right? So we have graph, documents. I'm not talking about document databases and other features that maybe everybody knows, but I wanna put attention on the reactive model. This is something very, very new. Anybody heard about reactive manifesto or reactive JS, for example? Okay. So let me explain the idea of reactive. So anytime you use the database that you are in production, maybe a relational database or any NoSQL, if you wanna get the updates, right, you have to query the database. Hey, you have updates for me? No. You have updates for me? No. You don't want to keep the server, right? So maybe you are not doing this every 5 milliseconds, maybe every 5 seconds, right? So you are wasting a lot of resources on the server because maybe you're looking for a data that is not in the database for a long time. If you think like when you are in the airport, right? You have all the flights, and every time there is a delay, you want them like immediately to get the updates, right? So can you imagine if over like in a Facebook-like application, can you imagine if you are logged in Facebook and you have like a new message or a new friendship request? Can you imagine if the client is calling Facebook database every second? So with just one server, one of the clients, you will keep any server, right? That's the scale. This is what happened. So I look for updates for a long time, but when the update actually arrives, maybe if I'm lucky, I get the update in real time, but maybe I have to wait 5 seconds, right? Till the next check. So I have a lot of waste of resources. With the reactive model, I can choose to query the database in a publish subscribe mechanism. So it's the same select, the same query, same SQL, but with a live prefix. In this way, the client just is listening for one or multiple queries. And every time there is a record that matches the word condition, the update is sent to the client immediately in a push mode. So it's the server that sends the message and push to the client, right? So I register my query at the beginning, like publish subscribe, and as soon as the update is arriving from an external source, for example, I get the update immediately. This is real time, without wasting any resources, because the client is just waiting, right? This is just a way to speed up all the application that need, you know, real time updates. Okay, so with a multi-model database, actually, if you want to create a quadrant, you can say that as a complexity relationship and data complexity, the graph actually are, you know, they can handle complex relationships, but they cannot handle complex data. For example, Neo4j is just the leader of graph databases. They don't support date or decimal time. If you want to store your salary, you have to use a double with a, you know, losing precision. Or you can store set, list, arrays inside the vertex. Instead, with a document database, you can have, like MongoDB, you can have embedded object, list, arrays, write maps, but you have non-relationships. So with a multi-model database, actually have the best of both worlds. We can see that relational databases actually, they succeed for a long time for this reason, because they actually were a good compromise between complexity of data and relationships. Cool, so let's see that. Yes.
Just now you have given an example for OrientDB live. Can you tell me one more real-time example?
Yeah, you can subscribe to one of the queries at the same time. So you can subscribe to multiple queries the same client. Sorry?
Any scenario?
Yeah, for example, in Facebook I want to look for the new messages and new friendship requests and maybe the new whatever, I don't remember how Facebook's called. So I have to subscribe to three different queries, for messages, for friendship requests, and to update the stream of Facebook, for example. So I can post three different queries, actually. So you can post any query you are interested in, and the client is just waiting for one of them. Any other question before the demo? We can have like question answer at the end of the presentation.
Data structure, right?
Sorry?
Your data structure, is it the same for all the different models?
Yes. It's a complex question. Yes, you can use, if you use the graph, for example, interface, you can still use the document interface. So all the interfaces, they work on the same data. So we have like, yeah, the kind of structure that is flexible and is the same for all the models. In the same structure.
And then BigData, you said there are like the second
ones
which are
free.
Which one?
Was. But the the beginning? This one?
Yeah.
Okay. These are the reason why Polyglot Persistence is very expensive. Maybe if you have Facebook or LinkedIn, you can afford having multiple databases, but usually a small company or with no huge budget, having multiple databases is less expensive. Cool. So let's go to the demo. Not spoil too much. Okay. So I've just, if you go on the website, you can go on the OrientDB.com, download the distribution, just a zip file. You can decompress the file, and you have this kind of directory. So this is the directory of OrientDB. If you go on bin, you can find server.sh or server.bat if you are using Windows. If you double click on server.sh, the OrientDB is starting. You can see that the first time it's asking for the password. Not, you have just run before the presentation, so it's not asking again. But the first time it asks for the root password of the server. You can see that OrientDB is listening on two different ports. The 2424 is the binary protocol, usually used by the drivers, and the 2480 is HTTP. And since OrientDB is an HTTP server, I can use OrientDB by just using core or a browser. And since I can use a browser, I can also connect to OrientDB by using this address. Let's see. Okay, this is Studio. This is the tool that we provide in bundle in the community edition. It's the way that you can interact with the database. Now I've installed three different databases. When you install OrientDB, there is the graph.dev concept graph. But you can download any other example database by clicking on the cloud. There are Game of Thrones, beer, whiskey database, so you can play with the Sorry.
It's compared with all the
platforms,
right? Like
no matter
the
platform, this is open source. Yes, this is open source. So we are looking only to the community edition. I just installed the Game of Thrones, so I use user password. And this is the browse tab. So here I can type any query. So OrientDB works with SQL, and this is good news because everybody knows SQL. So I can do select from B. B, we don't have table, we have classes, because everything is a object oriented inside only B. So B is the base class for vertices and E for edges. If you want to create like customers as vertex, you can extend B, right? So select star from B. Okay, this is the result. You can see that this is the record ID. You remember the immutable ID that already assigned the created vertex image? This one. And this is the class. So I just created the base class, so I get all the vertices, right? We prefer to provide a tabular representation because everybody is familiar with tables, right? Everybody is coming from relational database, Excel. So the classic rendering mode is just a table. But if you want to show the same result set as a graph, you can just click on this button on the top right, and you can create the graph. So with a double click, you are lazy loading all the connection, right? So this guy actually is Game of Thrones. I don't know if you're a fan of the TV show, but there are all the people and the battles and all the relationships of the characters. So I can see all the relationships, right? And if I click on the vertex, I can see all the properties on the left. So the name, title, blah, blah. I can also change the icon, the color, the size. And every time I change this representation, also the user, they see the same icon. So I can share actually the same visualization with other users. And this is a tool that we provide in bundle. So by looking at the graph, it's very easy for an end user, even if they don't know anything about IT or databases, but they can understand actually the data, because they can see the data and the relationship between data. I can even change data in this way. I can load tons of them, right? You can see with just double click, I'm just loading edges and connections. Let me see the other connections. Okay. So I can zoom in, zoom out, and this could be close to what Neo4j is providing. But we are doing something more. It's not just a visualization tool, but you can interact with the graph. For example, when I create a new connection between this guy. Okay. So if I create on the edge, I can create a link. You see, I'm creating an edge right now. I want to create an edge against this location. So every time I create a new edge, it asks for the class of the relationship. So these are all the classes of the relationship, like as a, as a founder, okay? Since a graph database is working schemaless, I can add properties to my edge. So I can create like a field like when, that is type of data, right? Okay, so I can pick type of data. This property is just for this edge. It's not for all the edges of this class. So I can work schemas about every single instance and different properties, or in ODB I can define schema. I have the choice, okay? So I can actually interact with the graph, change the relationship, keep, like I wanna destroy this edge. Yes, okay? So this implementation is working and I can work with the graph. Okay, so we have a schema. So in this case, I have a lot of classes and vertices like animal, man, battle, cast, a lot of them. I can have edge classes and you can see that I can create indexes. But you remember that graph databases have no indexes, right? Actually, we don't use indexes to cross relationships because we are direct pointers. But if you're looking for, like, give me the client with the name Luca, we need an index to justify to the record with the name Luca. So usually in the graph database, maybe you use an index for the first time just to look for the root vertex. As soon as you reach the root vertex, you can cross the graph in any direction. So the paradigm in the graph database is like a huge web and you are the spider. So you are not creating the database anymore, but you are this spider that you move across this web to do your research, to get your data, right? Okay, we are very strong in security. We have user role, user can have multiple role, and you can decide that one role can read or write this class or can delete this class, okay? We also have record-level security. So in the same class, for example, you create a class document, and you have like a CMS application. And you have two different users that write in the same class, but you can define it only be a record of security where every user can just query and access to their own documents. And this is perfect if you have multi-tenant application with the same database. Function. We have SQL, but you can extend our SQL in an easy way. For example, I like to create like hello world function in JavaScript. Actually, we support any language on top of the JVM, so it could be also Scala and any other language. I need a parameter, like name, right? And I want to return hello name. Okay, hello and the parameter. I can save my function. I can even test here. If I use Luca, you can see this is the result, right? Hello, Luca. So my function is working actually. The cool thing is that I can call this function immediately from the SQL. So if I do the same query like before, but I don't want to see, I want to see hello. Name. You can see hello. The name of the character. Okay, so now it's calling the name hello world, passing the field name to the function, right? So I can easily extend the SQL language, but it's just JavaScript. So there is no property language, proprietary language. And the same function, all the functions, are automatically exposed on an HTTP server. So if I'm invoking 2480 function, this one. Okay, error. I mean, let me zoom in. You cannot call this function because you didn't define the was example. And since we don't know if you are changing the database, you're using get right now, right? HTTP get. So you have to declare that, oh, I'm not changing the database, so I'm complying with the HTTP protocol with the get. So let me go back, let me click on idempotent, right? Okay, save, try again. Okay, hello Luca. So all the functions are automatically exposed in HTTP on the HTTP server. This is perfect if you want to create like microservices, but just using PolyB. And if you want to scale up with a different server, you can just have like 100 servers. You have data and function replicated. So when, oh, I can even exceed a query. I can do a lot of things here. For example, I can need to orient, get graph. I don't remember the syntax, so maybe this is not working. Query. Select from V init 10. Okay.
You need to stop. Select.
Yeah, it's optional. Maybe. Okay. It's not working. So the syntax is not correct. Maybe it's not graph. It's document. Let me check again. No. I don't know if this is like, sorry, but it has to work. No, okay, anyway. This is the main object to get the database instance, and you can execute the query, you can change the data, and whatever you want. Okay, with enterprise edition, actually, you can have multiple features like auditing, SQL provider, incremental backup, so there are additional features to the community. But this is the free version. Cool. If you want to play more with the Game of Thrones, we publish a demo in gogoi.com. With a nice interface, you can query the database just using the browser. So the multi-model databases are so flexible that they can be used, they can replace a lot of databases, right? We are very focused on security too. Just a quick look. So Barclays sponsored the Kairos plugin. We had like SAP, like a review on the HTTP server. We have strong encryption everywhere. We have SOAP password. So it's really strong for security. Even though most of NoSQL databases, they don't really care about security. What about distributed? We have a multi-master or active-active replication mode. This is something new for graph databases. For example, Info-J has just master slave. So with the master slave, usually, if you're one of the server, no matter how many servers you have, the bottleneck is the master. So all the writes has to go to the master. With the multi-master database, you can pick any node to read and write. So with OrientDB, we have an automatic discovery system. So if the multicast is enabled, usually in the cloud, you have to define the IP. Or with that, so we have the plugin that we get the IP from the configuration. But usually when you start a new node, so let's take an example. You start with just one server, right? But you need more power, right? So after a while, I need that is faster because I have more users than 1 week ago, right? So you start a new server. When the new server is started, it's actually looking for the cluster, an existing cluster. If it exists and the user password matches, it joins the cluster. And automatically the database is deployed to the new server. As soon as the database is deployed and it's coming online, all the clients, the existing client connected to the previous node, they are notified with a push message about the existence of the new server. And the same when the server is unreachable. So all the clients always knows about the cluster configuration. This allows to the client that when a node is switchable, they can actually repeat the transaction against another node. This is transparent. So with ODB, we get the failure and we automatically retry the same operation against the user. So we have no failure in the application. We just everything happens under the hood. We have transaction, so we are a transactional base. It's not very common in NoSQL. Actually, the base consistency works for a lot of use cases, but sometimes you need transaction, right? I've seen a lot of cases where people are using MongoDB, they need transaction, they implement the solid transaction on top of it. And of course, doesn't work very well, and it needs a lot of effort. So we are a very strong, consistent database by default, but you can elect the consistency to be eventually consistent if you want.
Yeah. I have a question with regards to the scalability. You think that this is an eventually consistent setup, then how do you actually guarantee the testing transactions?
By default, we have a strong consistency setup. So by default, we have a quorum mechanism. So the quorum by default is the majority. So for example, with three servers, every time the client writes a new record, he has to wait that two servers actually reply OK. As soon as the majority, in case of three servers, is two, we provide the OK to the client. So in this way, the database is always consistent. And if in background any server responds maybe with a delay, and we already provide the OK to the client, and the other server doesn't agree with the quorum, is that the server that is the coordinator just requires force the other server to have the same value, because the same value is owned by the majority. So the database is always consistent. But you can relax the replication probability to be eventually consistent.
How does this work across your
data
centers across New York?
Good question. What about cross data center? With enterprise edition, we provide a plugin that you can define the quorum is local to the data center. So you don't pay the cost of the of the server in another data center. So we have like a local quorum feature. But this is just enterprise. If you want to use the community, we suggest to if I want you to pay the the replication content, the replication cost, to use a synchronous replication. In this way, you are relaxed consistency, so it's eventually consistent, but at least it remains fast. You don't wait that the server maybe in the next data center is responding. Okay. Okay, this is zero config. So there is no complexity, just start a server. The server does automatically all the job for you. You can specify the quorum, the consistency level, there are a lot of settings, but by default, just works in a strong consistency mode. There's another interesting way to use ODB, and actually we have a lot of clients that use ODB in this way, is in a embedded mode. So if you are lucky enough to use a Java language for your application or any language on top of the JVM, you can embed the ODB server in the same JVM of the client. So server and the client, they represent the same JVM. This means that you avoid completely the TCP/IP network transport and latency. And this is blazing fast. And in this way, you can still have the replication. So you can have a lot of ODB boxes. You can have like 100 of these boxes where the application and the server lives in the same JVM. This is the best configuration for performance, of course. Any question? I've seen it. Okay. Cool. What about the integration with the different sources? We have a JVC driver, so you can interact with ODB with the existing tool. They are just working on top of the JVC driver. Sorry for my voice. It's almost gone. But we provide the ETL. It's very simple ETL, so you can use the web, whatever ETL that you want through the JVC driver, but we have our own ETL, it's free. This is the configuration on the right. You can see just a matter of a JSON configuration. So ETL means extraction, transformation and loading. So when you want to extract data from a source, transform and import in ODB. With this example, I'm extracting from a SQL. You can see that there is a driver.
Excuse me.
Yeah. This is integrated and available with the communication.
Sorry.
Yeah, absolutely. In this case, I'm doing starting start from client from a SQL. You can see the JDBC parameters. I'm transforming like whatever comes is the class client, and I'm storing it inside this ORDB database. That's it. So in this simple JSON, I'm loading an entire table from a SQL to ORDB. We also created Teleporter. Teleporter is an automatic tool when you want to synchronize an entire database to ORDB. Just one click and just works. The tool is smart enough to understand if you're using, for example, Hibernate. So we are, you are doing like inheritance by using Hibernate, because the rational base doesn't understand inheritance. But with ORDB, it's a true object-oriented database. So we have inheritance native in the database. So this tool is able to understand that you are doing like inheritance with Hibernate and restore the original inheritance in ORDB. This is just enterprise, but if you want to import database, I suggest you to download the enterprise edition, which is like 45 days trial. You can import database and you can start using community edition. This is cool if you want to synchronize the database like every day or every hour or every minute. So you can import data, but you can keep data synchronized. And so in this case, we have, for example, Oracle as a master database, because maybe you have a lot of legacy application, right, on top of it. You cannot just replace Oracle with ORDB. So you can still keep all the legacy applications on top of Oracle, and you can synchronize database with ORDB. And the new application could be built on top of ORDB, maybe analytics or maybe new application. And maybe after a while, you can decide, okay, you know what, we can provide this legacy application to work with ORDB, or maybe not. So if you need like synchronization, custom synchronization, you need the enterprise edition, but for just one time, you can use the trial, and you can, then you can work with the combination. So, Teleporter, the ETL, we have the GPC driver, you can connect any like Pentaho or any tool that will be GPC. We also have a Spark plugin. If you want to do computation, this is good, you can use the Spark plugin. And we have also imported from Info4j. So if you are using Info4j, there is a tool that automatically imports database inside ORDB. Okay, so since I don't know if you are familiar with DBEngine. DBEngine.com is a website that has the ranking of databases. It's not the best database, it's just the most popular database, right? So we climb a lot of position, and since there is no multi-model category, we are in different categories. You can see that we are the second graph database in the market today, after Neo4j, the sixth document database and key value, and in the total ranking, we are the 42nd. You can see that there is also Adabas access, because they still have a lot of, you know, web pages, so they are very popular again. But this is our ranking, and we are climbing this position, so it's becoming very popular. We want the best open source technology from InfoWare, and other papers. So if you're interested to work with ORDB, we have a free training. It's a video course, it's free. Go to ordb.com/getstarted. And this course has been already taken by almost 18,000 people today. Maybe we reached 18,000. This slide is now already updated. So if you want to understand, if you want to learn ORDB, go to the getstarted, get the video course. It's like a couple of hours, maybe. It's a basic course, but you can understand all the features of ORDB and you can start working with SQL, ORDB SQL. For specific binding, like Java language API, we don't have a video course, but if your company is interested, we can provide a training. Or you can just join a public class that we have every month. As a company, we provide 24/7, so if you want your production support, we can cover you. Okay, cool. So ORDB is a new technology, even though led the multi-model wave, and now all the most popular databases, like NoSQL databases, they announced to be multi-model, right? Who is using ORDB in production today? I just got a few of the comments that maybe for Singapore could be familiar. So you can see, maybe you are familiar with most of these companies. So these are all the companies that are clients of ORDB. Since we are very, you know, business friendly, so you can download ORDB for free without any registration, sometimes we discover the company that use ORDB like every day. For example, Dell, we discovered that Dell Statistica tool is using ORDB embedded. So all the processing of Dell Statistica analytics tool is using ORDB under the roof. We just discovered. But Most of them are clients. Okay. There are actually other companies, but we have NDA, so we can do it over here. We are increasing our partnership network because it's a new technology, and this is one of the reasons why I'm here, because I'm looking for partners. So if you're interested in ODB and your company could be a partner, maybe you are a system integrator, you can join the partnership. In Singapore, we have some users. The biggest one maybe is the NCS, that they're using ODB for a big use case, and they are becoming a partner. But there is room for also small companies to work with us. So every time with a partner, it's free, the partnership, so every time we have a client in Singapore and you are certified, we can provide you the client, and we split the revenues with the partner. So if you're interested, drop me an email, get my business card here, and we can talk about it. Cool. If you want to run ODB in the cloud, we have a partnership with the most used cloud platform. With Amazon, we have a special relationship because we are providing the ElasticScale ODB. It's the enterprise edition, but it's different because you can configure with the Amazon cockpit that, for example, when the ODB cluster CPU is more than 70%, create a new server. And when it's lower than 40%, destroy the server. So you can decide through the Amazon dashboard the rules to scale up and down with ODB. So this will be presented in maybe 1 month from now, maybe less. And maybe we will do the same for Microsoft, which is our second platform. So when we create ODB, we don't want to create yet another database to put in the NoSQL arena of more than 300 products. We want to create something special that can be actually be a replacement of a relational database or different databases at the same time. So it's not a database that you can use for analytics, that's fine. But ODB was born to be an operational database. And for this reason, we were the first graph database to be on the Gartner Magic Quadrant of databases in 2013. Thank you. Question. I have also three t-shirts. So, only three t-shirts, sorry. So, the best question, look at the t-shirt. I have all the three slides. Just L, sorry. XL and M. Questions?
In the models that you have, do you have any support for time-series databases?
No. We export in JSON. So as soon as you can read JSON and import in the time series, you can do ODB. So we export in JSON, in GraphML format, GraphJSON, and we have on backup and export.
A version?
Version on the our database, every record has a version ID that we increment. It is a multi-version concurrency control. But we don't store by default all the older instances. So it's up to you to create a model. It's very popular with the graph database to create a version system. There are also patterns to do that in that way.
Hi, what are the programming language support? Do you have drivers for, say, Python or other languages?
Good question. We have the native driver in Java, of course, but we have the .NET driver, Node.js, PHP, Python, Elixir. So we have the most common language we have a driver. Some of them are supported by the company, some of them they are just provided by the community. So little by little we are adopting all these drivers officially, so maybe the next one would be the Python driver that we will adopt officially as a company. So, but you can use ODB in so many languages.
Thanks.
You can go on the website and check on the binding. Oh, I forgot about the t-shirt, sorry. What size? M? Okay.
So just to confirm, one can create identity keys like primary foreign keys?
No, we use pointers.
Pointers. And so you can can do something like this. This is a unique data. You cannot repeat it, and then there's a referential integrity, like foreign keys. You can do that.
You can use something to be sure that that data is just present once in the database, like unique index. You can do that. But for relationships, we don't have foreign key, we just have pointers.
So the other question is, do you have some performance benchmarks like transaction processing console, something like that?
Yeah, well, you can find benchmark like cancer.gov, the research for the cancer. They publish a benchmark, they use MySQL, now they're using Orient. And you can tell that after the 7 level of depth, ODB was more than 1,000 times faster, not double, 1,000 times. So the more is complex the query, the more joined well, the difference is astronomical. So maybe two tables could be comparable, maybe some faster, but if you're like 6 or 7 level of depth of traversing, the performance, so with MySQL was more than 24 hours, the query. With ODB was 1 second. So it's much faster. And you can find this benchmark on the internet. Look for cancer, ODB, MySQL, you can find the page. Or if you write to me, I can send you the link, or I can find out. Yeah, good question. How can you scale horizontally or vertically? With a multi-master, it's very easy to scale up the reads because with any replication, because we have the same database, you know, replicated 100 times, so we have 100 servers to query, so we have 100 times better performance. The hard part actually is to scale up the writes. So to scale up writes, you have to use a sharding. And ODB is the only graph database that uses sharding. So playing with sharding and the replication, you can get the best performance. Because, for example, if you have 100 servers and you have the replication majority, means that every time they find the write, they have to wait for 51 servers to respond, and you can pay a lot of latency. But with sharding, you can decide that you can split the database in 100 partitions, right? And that partition is stored only on 3 servers, right? So the majority is actually 2 of 3, it's always 2, no matter how many servers you have. So by playing with the sharding, and the replication, you can scale read and write. With the current release, we support mana sharding. So it's up to you to decide when you write the data, I want this partition. But with the 3.1, we will provide automatic sharding.
Like, for example, in a microservices environment,
right?
Is it recommended to use your
sharing
use cases in microservices?
Yeah, with the microservices, actually, usually you have like blank boxes, right? So different databases. But we can use microservices on top of ODB by using the same database. So you can have like 3-4 microservices, they point to the same database. And this is much faster than, you know, using different databases.
I have a question. So how about the MDM kind of concept? Like, how do you create the golden record? Is it possible? I mean, you know what I mean, right? Because if you use open source, definitely you make public data like Twitter, all those things, right, when you gather, how do you form the golden record? Is it possible here, or can we configure that MDM kind of thing, like Informatica?
So I don't understand well. So with open source, it's about database or the web applications? So open source?
It's kind of, how do you create, it's a like MDM concept, right? Like Informatica, when you have a data integration, so also ETL tool and support. The MDM
multi-domain
configuration. So is it possible in
this
TV as well?
I'm not sure to understand correctly, but if you store, is it about the license? Sorry. 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 The
third time. Okay, maybe.
In the
license. Data governance. Simply if I am saying that data governance is possible.
Data consistency?
Governance,
sorry, okay. Yeah, absolutely. We use ODB for master data management. We have a couple use cases where you use ODB to map the metadata between databases. I don't know if answer to your question, but we usually...
For example, using same record and multiple feeding, right? Okay, I'm related to the same. So how do you identify the which one is the correct data? So for that, we need some trust level, or we have fuzzy logic to define which one, which column has to be taken from which source or the opposite. So likewise, right, we will form a similar record, which is called as a golden record. So to cleanse the multiple data from different sources. So do you have this kind of functionality in this DBMS?
Now in the database is one feature that we provide, but since you can work schemaless, you can put a lot of data and you can define then a procedure that clean the data. They clean the data and then you create a schema. For example, we have a use case where you just get data and store it on the DB, but after a while you want to create a schema on top of it. And you clean your data and you create a schema. And with OrientDB you can work schemaless, schemaful, or hybrid mode. So in the hybrid mode, you can define maybe name, subname, and the email are mandatories. Additional fields can be created by the user. So we don't have like a specific feature yet, but you can build on top of OrientDB.
Hi, I understand that you say that it is suitable for all users. So, but I just want to understand out there in the real world, what are the more popular use cases? Or is there any scenario that is more suitable for instance, like RDBMS, especially for transactional? So, what would this be more popular for or more suitable for? Is there a natural fit somewhere?
Yeah. The multi-model can be used in different use cases. So, we are planning to use OrientDB on top of the Raspberry Pi devices or multiple servers. So the biggest installation we can tell is an American company that they have more than 100 servers. But usually the classic installation is a 3 or 5 servers with OrientDB. The best use cases are all the use cases of graphs. So fraud detection, recommendation system, or social network. When we have a lot of relationships, usually the graph database outperforms any rational database.
Okay. So in that sense, if I'm thinking of a real-time forensic monitoring system where I have a huge volume of real-time data, would that be a good fit?
Absolutely. We have use case, if you look on NoSQL is an Australian company, but they have presence here, I guess. Yes, you can find this video, how they build and this folder, but doesn't matter. How they build this fraud detection by using OrientDB. It's a complex tool. You can fraud detection or forensic analysis, and they're using OrientDB under the hood. So look on Google about the cancers we got, like so yeah.
Just now you showed Elastic. So just a question: does this replace Elasticsearch?
Yes, you can use OrientDB as we have the same engine. We are using Lucene. So Elasticsearch and Solr, they use Lucene as an engine. So we are using Lucene for full text and spatial queries. But for other indexes, we have our own algorithm. So if you want to use full text, the search engine, we are using the same engine. So Elasticsearch, OrientDB, you can use OrientDB in place of Elasticsearch. Elasticsearch is more focused on just search. So usually if you just need a search engine, I suggest you to use Elasticsearch. Like if you need like a key value, just use Redis. But if you're, but in case of graph is different. If you want a graph database, I suggest you to use OrientDB because it's faster than Info-J and costs much less. But usually when you have a lot of complexity, it's where the multi-model helps a lot. Like complex domain, with graph documents, full text search, all together.
You mentioned earlier that when you add nodes, you will auto-replicate. But if you want to purposely see the database in a different domain, are you able to do traversal across domains?
That's a good question. So the only grail of graph databases with the sharding is find a way that... So with the sharding, you have a different partition, right? But can you imagine if you want to cross the database and you have to maybe cross a lot of servers a lot of times, right? So you pay a lot of latency. In this case, the best way actually is the way that all the graph databases, but Info-J are doing that with the sharding, is by using the private algorithm. So Google created this private algorithm. It's a sort of mesh traversal. So when you know the when you want to cross like one of the 1,000 edges, right? So you don't cross the server per single edge, but you are batching the traversal. So you are like grouping the edge, the traversal, and when you reach around 100, 1,000, you create a message and you pass the message to the server that it can continue with these 1,000 paths. It's just a way to minimize the traffic between servers, and it actually works pretty well. We didn't create this algorithm, it's by Google, it's called Prime. You can find Prime. There is an open PDF.
You said that you have an official spark
connector. Yeah.
So it's just the case where you have, let's say, 20 spark workers and you have things of processing and you write it back. Write back to OrientDB. Is there a transactional log thing or how fast could the writing be? Because there will be S consistency and you have 20 workers writing to the OrientDB and are there any logs from my experience that I have Neo4j, I have 20 workers writing to, say, a single Neo4j instance and it's locking every time due to transactions?
Yeah, with Neo4j your mass is late. So if you are running distributed, the mass is the bottleneck. So no matter if you are one of the servers, the poor server, the master server is the bottleneck. With OrientDB, every server is a master. So if you are using in the right way the partitioning, every node has never conflict with other database, with other servers. So every server can write and replicate without any conflict.
Do you have a mode where you can turn off the lock into some kind of batch loop mode so that you can write it quickly?
Yeah, we have a SQL batch. You can do begin commit and a lot of statements. And this is more efficient. Yeah.
How does OrientDB support offline model?
Offline?
Yes.
What do you mean for offline?
Some implementation customers do not want to connect to the outside world or may not want to connect to the public cloud. So they want their own data center.
Okay.
Quite offline from internet.
Yeah, we don't, even if it's a feature request that is very old, so if you go on GitHub, you can find this request, it's very popular. We don't provide direct support for this feature, but if you detach one server, if you isolate one server, you can still work with the other server, and as soon as the server reaches the network, actually download the delta, what happened in the middle. So this feature is not like a real feature that we provide that you can detach and touch and you can work with the database. It's just that you can isolate servers that when they match the cluster, they resynchronize. But if you want a consistent database, for example, you have five servers, right? And one server is isolated. If one client is connected to that server, it can never buy because it never reached the quorum. Because the quorum is five. So it's just a read database. So we don't have to assure consistency, but if you relax the quorum, actually works. And in case of conflict, we have a conflict resolution. There are different strategies, but you can plug your own. So works, it doesn't work. It's not like efficiently supported, but actually works.
And the last one, this space to me like a new space. So in terms of, this space looks to me like a new space. I'm not familiar with this space. But in terms of this space, who are your near competitors or, it is something so new that OrientDB is the only player in the market?
Yeah. Our main competitor with the graph, and the graph state, of course, is Neo4j. It's the most popular graph database. And Neo4j is dual license. They are GPL and commercial. So a lot of people think that Neo4j is free. It's not. So if you're using for a commercial product, it's very expensive. Really expensive. So with OrientDB, you can use the competition for free for any usage, even commercial. So we get different license first. Second one, if you want to get enterprise, the OrientDB version costs much less. And if you're using OrientDB, you have different features like multi-master, complex style, you have a multi-model database. So this is from a graph perspective. From the document database, we have, of course, OrientDB. We have the same feature, but we provide relationships within documents, actually. It's a nice feature. And in general, maybe our main competitor is the relational base, like Oracle. We have a base completely a relational base.
But by the way, I'm very impressed with your product. I heard you are the one man wonder.
I started this project a long time ago, but now there is a company. The company is based in UK. There is a team of people that work for the company, and we have more than 100 people that work in the project in the open source project. So they are not related to the company, but we have a lot of contribution for the rest through GitHub. So, and actually when we want to hire people, we go to GitHub, ordered by contributors, and we call the all these people, right? But it's really easy to hire people. So if you're interested to contribute to the project, you can download the OLP, you can follow the project, you can create a maybe special SQL function, you can send a request. We are very open to new contributions.
Just one last question for me. It's because you mentioned for each class, or rather for each node, there is a pointer to it, right? So it has an address. And say that I have Luca goes to Singapore. So there itself has two pointers already, correct? So let's say when you scale to billions or even more than that, that means your pointer value is forever increasing. Is that correct?
So if you scale, no, sorry, the last part, I missed the last part. If you scale to
big, yeah, if you scale to big, then your pointer value is it sequentially increasing or is it?
Oh yeah, okay. Yes, it's sequentially increasing, but we don't recycle positions. It's not a real physical position. It's a logical position. So we have an internal table that changes the physical position. So we have like the fragment method in the database. So when you delete the records, not like Log4j, the record are there forever. So we reclaim the space. So we change, we define the database, and we change the internal pointers. So it's a physical pointer, but you have two levels of interaction, if you look at it internally. So we can scale up, if you delete it and create data and delete it, you don't have like a database with a lot of holes. So if this is the question. So we can scale up very, very well with the millions of records. OLP is very fast. You can insert 1 million references with my computer in 6 seconds. So it's super, super fast in the session. So we usually actually work with billion records. We are very used.
I've got a question. So can this thing be used to create a lazy computation tree? So when you create a graph, a node in the graph is kind of static. You get an example of a function of a node, but can the result of a function of a node be a node itself? Or would it be easy to use this infrastructure to create a lazy computation graph, for instance, if a certain computation takes a very long time? You only want to compute it once and only when the input node have changed?
Yeah, good question. It's very easy, because the nature of the graph, you can create edges between vertices at runtime. So you can have a computation and you can maybe create different edges while you are computing the autoversal, actually. So for example, this is used when you want to maybe arrive from point A to C through 26 steps, right? And maybe in your use case, you want to create a direct connection between two vertices. So you can do that in real time, at the runtime, absolutely.
Okay, so there must be some kind of process that is mean you can't just create a node and write a small JavaScript under node.
You can do it with JavaScript, you can do that, like create a vertex, create edge, you know, this simple command. Or you can do the same by using Yelp. We also have triggers. So the best way usually, we call hooks. So you can hook the database and get, for example, we have the time series plugin. So you update the data and we keep synchronized in a synchronous way the tree of the metagraph of the time. So year, 12 months, every month, 51 days, every day, half, 24 hours. So you can create like a graph of the time. And we are doing the same. So with the hook, as soon as you update the vertex, we catch the event and we update the metagraph in a synchronous way. So you can do that, it's very easy. Much easier than the rational case.
I'm not too familiar with graph database, but any graph that could be the situation of cycling. How is that being handled in OrientDB?
Okay, good question. So if you have a cycle, you do a traversal loop, right? We catch the path, so we never repeat the same path. So you can create a city graph path, all the query languages, they support this pattern. So we just cross one path, the path just once. It's configurable, but very important we avoid loops. So when we have loops, we found that we already get this loop, we just go to the next path. So you never go in loop, actually.
I'm quite also new with the graph database. I just want to know whether I can run a spin plan like RDBMS for the this database.
Can you the question, sorry?
No, I'm just asking whether I can run a spin plan like RDBMS, Russian database. You can actually run a spin plan. So for this OrientDB database, right? Can I do that similar task?
Like run databases?
Sorry?
What do you mean like run databases?
No, a spring plan for a version database.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. You can do explain, select whatever, and you get the internal profiling on the query. It's been much easier. In 2.2, it's not really a reach, but after in 2.0, we are in the first milestone in a few days. We have the entire optimizer, you can see the optimizer of the path, and you can actually, it's pretty close to what Russian database offers. Yeah. Okay, thank you very much. If you have any other question, drop me an email or get my business card. There are a lot of stickers, there are new stickers, and maybe there is still pizza here. Thank you very much.